And one more spot. Oh, great. I gotta find my, little window. Here it is. Nope. Sorry, guys. Slight technicality. It's just so many things going on here today. Okay. All right. Okie doke. Okie doke. We're good to go. So welcome, everybody. Ray needs a collection of these expandable shirts. We'll just call these magic shirts. They do this weird thing where they get... It's the kind of fabric, you know? It's crinkly. Anyway, enough of that. All right, so we killed music, so I can put that away. So we're rocking and rolling. So welcome, everybody. I'm so glad you're here. It is a drama-free Friday. Yes, yes, it is. The drama-free Friday. And the reason we call it that is because the world is crazy. We know it. We all know it. Can't do anything about it for the next 2 hours, so we suspend. I hereby suspend. I do all my little magic tricks, and I hereby suspend all the craziness. It's out there. We're going to let it stay out there. We're going to stay in here and play and art and whatever we need to do. Agreed? Agreed. And to each and every one of you, I say cheers. Happy drama-free Friday. All right. So, what do I have to show you today? A lot. A lot. I'm so glad everyone's here. Thank you so much for joining me. We have a nice group and people are still coming in. That's right. Drama Free Friday, and have a little coffee, have a little tea. If you choose to have something else, go for it. Whoops, I got the wrong glasses on. I got on my Sally Jesse Raphael glasses. And if any of you know Sally Jesse, you'll know why those are that. No wonder I couldn't see. No wonder I couldn't see. I had the wrong glasses on. Carrie's off dancing to the sound of her Keurig. Yay. Two thumbs up for that. I don't have one, but it sounds cool. All right. I got something fun in the mail this week. Thought I'd show it to you. Pardon all the other clutter that might creep into the shot here. Yes. This is the happiest of happy mail. Yes, it is. Do you see where it's from? Mm-hmm. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. That's right. Die. Vaughn needs lids on everything. Well, you might have just put the pox on me. You might have put the pox on me, Vaughn. I'm so... That might not have been a good thing you just did. Hi, Jean. Yes, it's from Con. You're supposed to say Con. I'm trying to use the right pronunciation. It's from Con. Yeah, it was a postcard from my son who was in Con the middle part of May, and I just from the like the 10th to the 20th of May, I just got it. I just got it. Yeah, is that funny? I just got the postcard, and he said he sent a whole bunch of them. Everything with the same day, same post office, same everything, same day. And his that he sent to himself beat him home. Mine, I am 1,500, let's see, how far am I away from him? I don't know, 1,500 miles, 2,000 miles, I don't remember. Anyway, away from him, closer to where he was. It took me like 2 more weeks to get it. I know, so funny. Anyway, that's a cool picture, isn't it? Very cool. So that was true happy mail. Came from the happiest of sources. The happiest of sources, my amazing hot son, who sometimes sneaks in and watches. Hi, Dana. I missed what happened with Anita. Somebody will have to type it back in the chat again because I missed what it was. Everybody's congratulating Anita K, and I don't. I missed the whole thing. Missed the whole thing. Yeah, I missed the whole blooming thing. Hi, APG. Let's see, what else do I have to show you? Oh, right at the very end. Okay. That's allowed. Everybody's allowed to work and do whatever they want to do. I'm here to just keep you company. Oh, 24th anniversary. Oh, cool. Thank you. Thanks for telling me that. Congratulations, Anita K. Ours was this week also. Unfortunately, well, I don't say it's not unfortunate. It's very fortunate. Ours is a few years longer than Anita K's. Not unfortunate at all. I don't know why I even said that, silly girl. I'm going to show you this real quickly, and then I may show it again at the end of the show. But at the end of last week, we like at the very, very end said, oh, and by the way, we have the mandala book ready. And I thought, well, you know, I should give it a proper introduction. So that is what I'm going to show you right now. So this is the brand new ebook that we got finished and rolled out literally last Friday. So here it is, a drum roll, please. This is what it looks like if you print it out and put it in your own book. Now, you don't have to print it out, of course, but I guess I could talk to you, couldn't I? You don't have to print it out, but this is printed out, and it's put into what's called a half-inch binder. See that? It actually measures an inch, but I think it's called a half-inch binder. Anyway, so this is what it looks like. So I just thought I would show it to you. I printed the whole thing out and put it in the book just so you could see what it looks like. So I printed the first few pages just on regular text paper. And there are some examples of some of the different mandalas that I did, that I colored, just to give you some inspiration. There's a table of contents. Now, let me explain to you, because somebody's going to give me grief over this, and I understand that. But I'm going to explain to you the methodology behind the madness. There are numbers here, but there are no page numbers. And that is done specifically so that... Thanks, Carrie. That is done specifically so that when you print out your mandalas, you don't end up with a page number printed on it as well. Okay, so that's why. So in order for you to figure out what is what, you're going to have to kind of cross-reference and go, okay, this is the first one, this is the circle of pods, or circle pods, okay? So that's the reason. I didn't want to put page numbers on the actual images in case you wanted to print them out and draw them and do something with them. Okay, so here is just an introduction to the mandalas. And if you look at the electronic version on your computer, which it's completely downloadable, if you look at it on your computer, there are some things highlighted. You can click on those. That'll take you. If you want to find out more about what those things are, you can take a look at that. So here are the images. I'm going to just flip through them, but they fill... They go as wide as I could get them on the paper. If you punch them, you're going to punch out part of some of the designs. So, you know, that take that for what it is worth. These I printed on cardstock because my little... And I, believe me, have the cheapest of printers. And this is an inkjet printer that I printed this out on. And so I... printed this out with cardstock. So my El Cheapo HP printer will take cardstock. And this is, I didn't try it with the 110 pound. This is 60 or 65 pound. Vicky, good grief, it's so good to see you. I haven't seen you in ages. I was wondering about you the other day, Larkspur Vicky. Glad to see you pop up in the chat. It did print out very nicely. Yeah. So here are, let me go back, let me flip through them just so you can see the various and sundry images. So this is the actual size that they print out. Okay, just like so. This one is on the blog on HowToGetCreative.com. This is a blog post that shows you exactly how to draw this one with using a compass. Stepped out. So if you want to see how to do this and you don't have a book, there's 25, Anita K. There's 25 patterns. But you can see how to do this, and you can make other ones. So I did pack the book. This is one of my favorites. I just love the rose. I really do. And then not every mandala has to be completely round. So here is this one. And I like this one too. But they all have names, but I decided I was not going to mess up the pages with page numbers or names. So if you print them out, they're just completely plain. And CB says, she suggests if you're using an inkjet with wet media, you might spray it with fixative. Yes. And what I use personally is I use the Krylon Matte Finish 1311. That's what I like to seal something. I did find that using the cardstock with an inkjet printer, as long as I was using markers, I didn't get any smearing. So, thanks, Rain. So I didn't get any smearing with them, but and I used I used pit pens, pit markers, the big brush pit markers, and I also used the El Cheapo Crayola Kids markers, and I didn't experience any smearing. Now, if you're gonna do watercolor and stuff like that, I don't know that you want to print it out on cardstock because it's gonna buckle and carry on. But anyway, I like this one too. I like them all. You know, it's like giving birth to a child. You know what I mean? And then at the back, it just gives you some ideas as to what to do with the mandalas. And then gives you the links where you can find me online. So that's how it prints out. And this is the quick link to get you there. Straight to it if you want to see it. The book is on sale right now. Hold on a minute. I got to get the right keyboard bit here. There's the quick link that'll take you straight to it if you want that. Or you can get to it through the blog. No problems. But it is http://create, which is C-R-8. It stands for create.me/mandala ebook. Now, the book is on sale right now for $6.97. Oh, the alcohol mark. CB says the alcohol markers will cause it to move. Okay. Okay. How bad is the odor on the Krylon Finish spray? It's not as bad as Krylon Fixative, which I positively cannot stand. It's not as bad as that, but it is still odory. I would never use it in the house. So, but it dissipates. I find it dissipates much faster than the Krylon Workable Fixative. So, yeah, exactly. CB, I don't have, I have a few alcohol markers. Dana is the one that used them with alcohol markers. And Dana, what did you do? Did you fix it? Because you used yours with Copics, I think. Dana will have to tell you. You guys will chat about that. All right. So anyway, the book is on sale for $6.97 until Wednesday, which is June the 10th. Then it'll go to the regular price, which is $9.97, which is still not a big deal. I think that's a steal. Personally, I think it's a steal for all the work that went into it. But, you know, there you go. So Dana says that she used a cheapy Canon printer and she didn't fix it first. So I think it really depends on your ink. I think it really, really depends on your ink. So anyway, there's the front cover. It shows you this, which is the compass rose. This one was colored. This one was a combination of the pit pens and the Crayola markers, I believe. And then it shows you what it looks like out here when it's not colored. So, yeah. So anyway, you guys, here's the thing. When you print on your printer and you try it out, you're going to have to just see. Print one, you know, print one of them out and take a look at it and see, you know, with whatever your marker is, see if it's going to work, see how your ink reacts. My HP ink, for whatever reason, doesn't seem to move when I use matte medium or gel medium or Mod Podge or anything else on it. I have not, Cindy. I don't know what that is. Yantra mantras. I don't know what that is, Cindy. I'm sorry. Yeah, so I think it really, really depends on your printer, your ink. You got to try it out. So, all right, so there is that. That is the Mandala Melange. So if you're in the mood and you want to just zone out for a while, print out one of those and or a few of them, I'll tell you what I have is, let me see, can I show you? Yes. I can show you exactly what I use. We're going to do a whole bunch of things today, maybe. I'm thinking we're going to do a whole bunch of things today, but we shall see how far we get. So this is what I use. This is a piece of, it's kind of like formica with a back on it. It's like an eighth of an inch thick. It's some kind of building material. Now, granted, it's dirty, right? But it's white. Okay, Cindy, thanks. If you would tweet that to me, I can't go there while I'm streaming, but if you want to tweet that little thing to me, the name of that, I'll look it up. That would be great. And if anybody wants to follow me on Twitter or Facebook, those links are at the back of the book. I should just tell them to you, shouldn't I? We'll find out here. Okay, so on Twitter, I'm at Barb Owen Designs. That was an S at the end, Barb Owen Designs. On Facebook, you can follow me at How to Get Creative. You can also find me there as Barb Owen. And then YouTube, Barb Owen Designs. Okay, so those are how you can get to me. So anyway, if you can tweet me stuff that you want me to know about, that's the sure way for me to get a hold of it. So anyway, this is just like white formica, and I made tapes and stuff on top of it, so it's stained. I need to clean it up. I wrapped it in duct tape because the edges were sharp. And this is the thing, it's stiff enough that this is what I take with me when I'm gonna go sit on the couch, you know, do Paula's art from the couch thing. And so I thought I would show you a little bit. I mean, I literally take this and it's big and it's small, but it's big enough that it holds all my stuff, right? And so what I've done here, in case you guys didn't see it, I did a YouTube tips and tricks. That's one of the new things that we're doing is on YouTube, we're doing tips and tricks videos that are short. And you'll have to stay tuned for those. Follow me on YouTube if you want to get the notification about that. And so I did a tips and tricks video about how to use stuff out of your kitchen to draw a mandala so you don't have to have a compass or anything else. Nothing fancy. So that's what this was. This was watercolor paper. This happened to be 140-pound. And I put washes of acrylic paint on it and just let it dry. And the texture in here came from blotting it with paper towels. So what I did then was I drew the design. And it's a matter of just draw a design, as I showed you on the YouTube video, and I've shown you guys here before. Just draw a design. And then repeat the design as you go around. Now you could subdivide this if you need it in pie shape so it gives you more, more structure or whatever. But I usually just go for it and see what happens. And sometimes it comes out great. Most of the time it does. All right, so what I've been doing with this one, I thought, well, I'll just show you. These are Inktense pencils. So, here's a link. If you don't know about Inktense pencils, this will just, you can go click on the link that I'm going to put in here in just a second. And you can go take a look at them just because it will give you some more information. So that will show you what I'm using. This is the 24 set that I have here. I'll tell you the things I love about Inktense. I'll tell you the things I don't like about them. For anybody who is watching a recording, it's create me. So it's CR8.me/Inktense, I-N-K, T-E-N-S-E, Pencils 24. So that is, if you want to find out more about that, you can go take a look at those. So this is the set of 24 that I have here. I also have the set of 12. I'll tell you what irritates me about Inktense Pencils is that when you buy the set of 12 and then you buy the set of 24, the set of 12 is included in the set of 24. And I think that's irritating. Then if you go buy the set of 72, all the 24 are included in the set of 72, which I also find irritating. But it's a great way for my granddaughter to get some art supplies, isn't it? It's a great way. So that's the small thing that irritates me about Inktense. And if I have given you misinformation, you guys feel free to correct me. What I would like to say is I would not bother with the set of 12. I would go straight to 24 or 72. Exactly, Joyce. Exactly. Just buy them all, and then that way you get them. All right, so what I love about them is I love the fact that the leads are pretty hard. So just a cheapo pencil sharpener, I find, sharpens them quite adequately. And they are not prone to breakage like the Prismacolors are. So I just thought I'd show you what I do on this, just so you know. This is one way of using Inktense Pencils. Now, what's down here is acrylic paint, all right? And you can do this with anything. This is acrylic paint. It's dry. It doesn't move. Exactly. Just buy the 72 and there you go. So this color happens to be poppy red, and so I am coming up over a base color, and you get some variations, some shifts and variation in the colors around here because there's stuff already down on the paper. So this is what I do. Now there's a million different ways to do things, but this is the way that I do it. I just, to get some twisting and turning and dimension in the shapes, I just kind of go around the shape inside of it, or sometimes I'll only do part of a shape, and so that will pop part of it. They are an investment, but I will tell you, I have worked with this same set of 24 Inktense Pencils, and I've done a lot of stuff with them, a lot. And do you see that I haven't even dented, literally? You can see that they're almost still. Now this one over here, this pencil right here, which is, I think this is, let's see. This is ink black, and I don't tend to use that one very much. And I don't know, can you tell that one is clear from end to end? Okay, that's end to end in the case. And here is, the yellow is probably the shortest. The yellow and the sea blue are the shortest in the whole thing. And I've hardly used any of it. You know? Yeah, Jan says she built her own palette. Yeah. Hi, Sandy. So they last a really long time. Yes, they are an investment. I can get rid of this thing because we don't need that. So anyway, I just go around, and I work from the center out just because that's what I like to do. This is a great thing if you like to watch, or if somebody in your family likes to watch sporting events, or you like to watch them. You can accomplish something at the same time while being in the same room. You know, you can do all kinds of stuff. So it doesn't take very long. You don't have to be real persnickety about it. And when I sharpen these, I don't sharpen them super pointy, you know, to a super pointy point. All right, so let's just do half of this one. So I'm just going around this petal shape here. That's about half. And then I have lots of different water brushes. And hi, Kyla. Kyla, I'm going to show your my first book from your class, too. So stay tuned. It's coming up. Let's see. these, here's a little link if you want to check out the kind of water brush I'm going to show you. Dee Dee Inkywell is the first one who showed this, who talked about these, the Pentel water brushes. So for anybody that's watching the recording, that's the link. If you want to check them out, you're welcome to do that. The thing I like about this water brush, and I haven't used it a lot, but I've used it for a couple weeks, I guess. One of the things I like about it is that the barrel in it is flat. I don't know if you can see that, but the barrel's flat, and the silly thing doesn't roll. This is a nice one. This is the Niji water brush. But do you see? It rolls where this one doesn't. So when you're sitting at an angle or you're sitting on the couch and your work surface is an angle, it doesn't go anywhere. When you set it down, it stays there. And these are nice. I also have the El Cheapo ones, which I don't think I can put my hand on. And this is one of the Tim Holtz ones. Now this one I like because it has a big, wide, fat tip. That's a Tim Holtz, which I think is by Kiritaki, I think. Anyway, it's a nice brush too if you're doing bigger areas. But anyway, this is the one that, this is just sort of basic. I don't know the size tip on this one. Anyway, it's a nice bristle. So I just get the Inktense wet. I activate the Inktense and then just kind of pull it into the center of the shape. Now when it dries, the Inktense dries, you get a different look. You certainly don't have to use them just on mandalas. You can use them on all kinds of things. But it goes very quickly. And the thing that I find with this water brush, personally, is you don't have to pump it. It just feeds, the gravity seems to just feed the water right on down into the brush tip. I don't know how it'll work long term, but you know, I've been really, really happy with it so far. Yeah, this one is, I think is a 3 size dealy. And I don't, the El Cheapo ones are, you know, they work, but they're not my super duper favorite, but they work, you know. They come 3 in a set, the cheap ones, and I don't know that they even have a brand on them, but, you know, they're available as well. So I just activate the ink. Now, you do have to activate all of the ink for them to become permanent, right? And if you don't activate all the ink and you come back and you touch the unactivated ink with water, it will, you know, activate and you'll think, oh, they didn't dry. Well, it's not necessarily the case. You just didn't get all the ink activated. Now, when you go over these, so we'll say that that's what we want to do. And Dee Dee recommends, Inkywell recommends using a Kleenex to clean them. And I agree with her on that. But my Kleenex or tissues are somewhere else, so we're going to use a paper towel. And it takes very little to get rid of the ink and go back to clear water. I'm not squeezing it or anything. Yeah, and Joyce, Moonrose Joyce, likes to use them on fabric, and they are beautiful on fabric too. Yeah. So that is nice, right? Now, all of this in here has one coat of Inktense, so I thought, and it's thoroughly dry because I did that last night. So I thought maybe we'd take one of these in here and we'd add a little additional color to it. So this is a dark brown, which I may not like, but you know, it's like, I don't even care because it's just a piece of paper. So I'm gonna use this dark brown called Bark. And these two shapes right here, although they're different colors of the Inktense, are really close in tone. So I'm gonna come back over that. I'm not gonna re-outline it. I'm just gonna put a little bit in the corners. And I usually find I have the best luck if I keep turning the shape or the piece of paper or whatever you want to call it, the mandala. So I'm just going to put in, again, I'm only going to do part of this one. So I'm not putting in nearly as much color as I did the first time. So I'm just kind of going in the corner, in the corners. And I'm going to come back to my water brush and I'm going to activate that. And if it starts dragging out too far, then just keep blotting your brush tip. If the pigment's traveling further than you wish for it to travel. So you can layer them up, but as you layer them more and more and more, the paper becomes sealed, as it were, with pigment, and so they don't tend to be as permanent when you start layering them up. The Inktense comes in blocks as well as in pencils, and I have the set of 12 blocks, and I like those to work off of the Inktense blocks. I'll just wet them with the brush and take the pigment over to the piece. But you can also color with the blocks. They're like sticks. They're like Prismacolor. A lot of different companies have this pigment in stick form. And they're nice because they cover a lot of area. Okay, so can you see the difference now that that's made? So you can see part of it, this part. So that has immediately popped up that red star shape, or you know, whatever you want to call those. Anyway, that's what I did to color these, and this particular one is done exactly that way. All right, so this mandala which I've cut in half was done exactly that way. And this is also one that I drew using stuff from my kitchen cabinets. The circles came from that. All right. So this is done exactly the way I just showed you. And neither this one nor the orange, green, yellow one, neither of those have I added a bunch of the black and white to it. You don't have to, and I thought I would show you, but you see some variegation in it because of the color from the wash that was underneath it to begin with. So that is one way that you can color your mandalas that we haven't talked about before. Okay? Okay. Thank you, Imelda. All right, so that is a quickie little yakety-yak about that. Any questions about that? If not, we're moving on. Lots of chat about pocket letters in the chat, which is good. Provençal, there you go. Okay, so that's what we'll talk more about this later, but I just wanted to show you, pardon me, how you could use the Inktense pencils to get from point A to B, or C, or D, or E. Okay, now, I have a whole bunch of these, and you'll see why in a little bit. Okay, I have a whole bunch of these. This is 90-pound watercolor paper. It's the cheap Artist Loft. I bought some new pads of this today because I was out. It was $4.99 at Michael's for 25 sheets, 90 pound, and that's what this is. And I like this particular watercolor paper because although it's cold pressed, it has a pretty flat finish. It's not as flat's not the right word, but it's not as textured as most cold press papers, I find. Okay, so I just wanted to show you that, and most of this business over here is unusable to me, so I'm going to cut it off. So I'm just going to get rid of that. But I wanted you to see what I was working with. So it's essentially scraps. And as I said earlier, we're going to do several things today. So, this is the next thing we're going to do. So I have a palette and I have, pardon me, time to drink. I'm telling you, streamers, the pox of streaming is the clogged up throat. It is the pox, and we pass it from one to another. Dee Dee had it this morning. She gave it to me, and I am going to give it to Paula, Journal Artista, because she gives me a bunch of trouble. Hi, Jonna. All right, I'm going to use some black. This is just inexpensive black acrylic paint. This is a small brayer. I'm going to, let's see, do I have my, I'll just work on it. Okay, sorry, had to think for a minute. I'm going to brayer this out. As I said, we're doing several different things today, so I'm just brayering it out on my palette because I don't really want very much. Okay, so I'm just kind of spreading it out on my palette. So I have the brayer kind of covered, but you see how it's not super coverage like that. That's what I'm after. Okay, so I'm just going to brayer out some black. I don't care about these little bits over here. I don't want a full coat of black. That's what I'm after. Okay, pretend that you were doing jelly plate printing, if any of you have, okay? Pretend that you're jelly plate printing and you're just cleaning off your brayer. That's what this is, what we're doing here. So I'm going to do about, three sheets of this. All of a sudden, I want to say three sheets to the wind. That is not good. Anybody knows that expression? That's not good. So I'm just putting some black paint. Okay? And it will dry very quickly. It will dry very quickly because there's not very much paint on it. Okay? All right. So there you go. And then I'm just going to use a little bit of a baby wipe because if I was not in a streaming position, I would jump up and I would go over and wash my brayer under the faucet. But because I am streaming, I'm just going to clean it off using a baby wipe. If you're watching a recording and you would like to get in on the live chat, because there are live chatters, friends in the box, as it were, so I clean off my little brayer. Come over to ustream.tv, creating faces, on Friday afternoons at 2 p.m. Eastern. Okay, so we're done with that. I'm going to put away this black paint before I get my hands into it. Or before a cat walks through it. All right, let's see if we can give this a little shot of heat. So Anita says, Anita K says, Windex removes paint wonderfully from stencils, hands, and brayer. Good to know. Well, you know that guy on the dad on My Big Fat Greek Wedding, he said he used Windex for everything. Which, by the way, just a point of information, Nia Vardalos, the gal that directed, but I can't remember, the actress in My Big Fat Greek Wedding, Hot Sun has done some work for her in the past, so that was fun. Okay, so we have some dried acrylic paint on here. And then I'm going to use my El Cheapo. These are Prang watercolors. Prang watercolors. I didn't get my water over here. All right. So I'm going to have to go get my water container. So I shall be right back. I missed what Jonna discovered. So Jonna, you're going to have to put it back in. You're going to have to put it back in because I missed it. I have to put it back in the chat because I missed what it was that everybody was loving. Makes it go away and not itch. Well, what is it? Because let me tell you. Windex on mosquito bites? Really? I'll be darned. Well, that's interesting. That's interesting. All right, so these are a set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 16. Is that right? Yes. Look here. 16. I can count. 16 Prang watercolors. They are well used, and they last a long time. A long time. I was very tempted, I have to say, to buy another set today just because I wanted one. I'm like, what are you talking about? You still have them. So I'm going to spray them with some water. All right, so I have water. I have a container with water. I'm going to just use the washes. So some of this stuff out here will work just fine. So picking up water. And this is where I'm going to get colors into my background. Okay. That's why you don't want to fill up all the space. With your black paint. If you like this kind of look. And if you have some extra space out here, that's where you can test out your colors. So I'm just kind of dancing around the page, letting some of them overlap. This is just background stuff. And let some of the colors bleed together if you want to. Okay, and that's it. Now, it's going to curl and carry on. If you want to give it a little help, you can spray the back of it with water. Okay, you can spray the back of the paper with water, or you can just set it to the side and let it dry. Because it's going to curl up and do all that stuff, because it's inexpensive El Cheapo watercolor. And if I have any of it that starts pooling, just, you know, sop it up. Sop it up. Go to the next one. All right. So we're going to try to make some different colors here. I always tend to go back to those blues, greens, purples for whatever reason. So we're going to see if we can make ourselves do something else. But I like the fact that these watercolors are, I think they're called semi, what are they called? Semi something, semi, well, I can't look on the other side right now. Semi moist or something like that. I know, Rain, right? Rain says that the blues, greens, and purples are very calming. But I also, if I'm going to wear color, I always tend to reach for, if I have my choice of color to put on myself, I will go for red. I love red to wear. I used to hate to wear black. Hated when my mother wore black. And now I like wearing black. Like, when did that happen to me? I don't know. So anyway, there's one done with yellows, oranges, a little bit of red. All right. And let me show you this one that is so curled up. Wait a minute. Let me wipe off the surface here. This one that was so curled up a second ago has already started flattening out. So the paper curls up a lot, and then it, as it dries, it flattens itself back out. And so I generally just sop up the color, you know, sop up some color from it like that. Set it aside, let it dry. Now, the more you saturate with water, the longer it's going to take it to dry. Hello, Mitzi. Black makes you look slimmer. That's right. Okay, let us go. Put some, this is regular blue. Regular blue, and we'll do some regular green. And Larkspur Vicky, if she's still here, is having an absolute stroke over the fact I'm using kids' watercolor. If you want to see, there's Vicky speaking of. Uh-huh. Bye, Jamie. If you want to see real bona fide watercolor, then you need to go tune in, go take a look at Larkspur Vicky's. Vicky, if you have access to your link where anybody can see your amazing watercolors, pop it in there. If you want to see really nice watercolors, you need to go check out Larkspur Vicky's paintings, because I'm here to tell you, they are beautiful. Okay, so we're just gonna sop up the real messy stuff. Okay, so we have, and as they dry, they tend to lighten in color. So I can sense things out of the way. Okay, so here's the first one that I did, right? There's the next one I did, and here's the last one I did. So they're gonna lighten in color. And they're really nice. I like the praying watercolors a lot. I think they're very pigmented and intense for kids' watercolors. Okay, so we're gonna just set these aside, let them completely dry. And your watercolor set, when it gets nice and wet like that, do not, under any circumstances, fold this up and put it away like that, or you will open it up and it will be moldy. Don't do that. All right, so here's what I made using that background technique. If Kyla's here, there she is. Oh, your sight's down. Okay. So here's what I did using the very same thing that I just showed you. And this is my first little book from the One Page Wonders class from Kyla. And Kyla, feel free to stick your... Okay, so Vicky said, Larkspur Vicky says, Google Vicky J. Barton, V-I-C-K-I-J, that's her middle initial, and Barton, B-A-R-T-O-N. And you'll see some of her images. Okay, so anyway... Kyla, if you want to put in your link for how people can get to this, your One Page Wonder class, e-course she calls it, then go ahead and stick it in there, because I'm going to show this. So this is the first book that I did. I used a piece of Canson mixed media paper. I had it in size 14 by, no. Oh, good grief. Let me go find it. I'll tell you what size I used. Fourteen by seventeen inches. It's the pad. It's the big Mamba Jamba pad that I use when I'm braying off, cleaning off my brayer when I'm doing jelly plate printing. Okay, so that is what I used. I took the full sheet and made the little book. So this is a one, it's made from one page. And in the class, Kyla talked about, she referenced using this as a card, as a greeting card. And I'm like, whoa, my anniversary. It was this week. Number 42. I don't think I'm even 42 years old, let alone have been married for 42 years, for crying out loud. I'm telling you. Thanks, Kyla. It's kylagiveHand.com/one-page-wonders with an S dot HTML. So there you go. Or I know you can just go to kylagivehand.com, K-I-A-L-A-G-I-V-E-H-A-N-D, kylagivehand.com, and you'll see it right there. So there you go. All right. So it was our anniversary this week, and so I decided to do another way of using the mandalas that I had done. I decided to use those in a different way and make, thank you, and make my one-page wonder book, so I would do that, and then make it into a card. So I just killed all kinds of birds with one stone, and I love, I know, I'm terrible, but I love being able to do that, incorporate lots of things into one thing. So that's what I did. So this background that you've seen me do right here, that I created, yeah, exactly, Deb. She says, isn't that the anniversary we're supposed to receive art supplies? Yes, it is. If Clawsman's here, is he still here? He's here. You should tell him that. And Dara says she's still 39, even though her birth certificate says her actual date of birth. I will not say that on recording. I'll let her say that. Yes, exactly. So I took my mandala images, which I have some more here. Let's see. And we're going to use them after a bit. I put my images that I had colored. I had drawn them and colored them. These are all from the book, except for this one. This one was not. And so I made them in different sizes. My printer was not working on part of them, so, but that doesn't mean that they're all unusable. And I printed them out on 24 pound white, super white paper. And then I started, after I made the book, then I started playing with them. I know, Dar. I know. I know. So I started playing with them, cutting them apart, and deciding how I was going to do the book. So this is about our anniversary, okay? So I found some quotes that were appropriate that worked for the circles, the concept of the circle, because I think of a circle in terms of, you know, being married and blah, blah, blah. And so this quote is, cherish yesterday, dream tomorrow, but live today. So you'll see that. So the next page is, so there's a mandala here that you can barely see. That happens to be this one. Okay, it's this mandala that I just reduced the size. Says, we're not going in circles, we're going upwards. The path is a spiral. We have already climbed many steps. And that is really true. Because we got married when I was quite young. And he had a daughter. And so I became an instant mother when I wasn't a whole lot older than she was. And then a couple years later, we had hot sun. And yeah, we have climbed many steps. It's true. So these I printed out on, I have two printers. My one is an inkjet. The other one is a laser, inexpensive. What is the font? Oh boy. I can't tell you, Joyce. I don't remember what it is. I can tell you afterwards. I can tweet it to you, but I can't tell you right now because I don't remember. I did lots of choices, and this was the one I liked the most. Yeah. It could be papyrus. I don't know. Yeah, wish I could tell you. So that was what, so I printed these out on the same, let's see, 20 pound or 24, 20 pound, this is just 20 pound paper. I printed out and I sprayed them because it was laser. It was a laser print. Or laser, yeah, laser print. There was no chance of it running because it was a laser print, not inkjet. So I put it in my spray box and I used this Tattered Angels Glimmer Mist. And this this color is turquoise blue. I've had this forever. It still sprayed pretty well. This one is a Lindy's Starburst spray in Delphinium Turquoise. And it's totally clogged up, which I'm like irritated about. But, you know, I have a love-hate relationship with sprays. I absolutely love them and I absolutely hate it when they don't work. You know? I hate it when they don't work. So, not to be outdone, and I didn't have another sprayer to put in the bottle, so I just unscrewed it and took out the feed tube and just splatted it. So that's where the splats came from. And then I let it dry, and then I put them, I actually used an iron to make sure they were dry. And I ironed the paper with a warm setting from the back so it flattened all the paper, right? I know, I love them and hate them all at the same time. Then I cut them out. I didn't ink around them or anything. I just cut them out and put them in the book. I will have to say that if I were to do this again, because I'd never done this quite this way before, if I were to do it again, I would plan carefully where I was going to put these, and I would cut these apart, and I would let them be separated in the spine area where it's going to fold of the book. I found it a little problematic going across the fold. So, all right, the next page. If you love someone, put their name in a circle, because hearts can be broken, circles never can. So this is another mandala. This one is an uneven edge, so I cut it out on the unevenness of the edge. Barb, Lindy's will replace clog spray. I know, I just have to, you know, deal with it, right? What did Mitzi say? I missed what she said, so I need to put it in the... You sprayed purple up your nose, Joyce. That's bad. That's funny. Joyce, or Mitzi, I'll have to put that back in the chat because I didn't see it. And that way I can read it off for the recording. Something that works. And I missed it. So this is the rose mandala done in really pastel colors. Store the sprays upside down. Okay. Thanks, Anita K. All right. Thank you. And so what I did here, and I did a similar thing on this one. I punched out a circle, right? Because I wanted this color from this to be repeated, even though the colors were here. The center was busy. So I punched out a smaller circle, and I glued it in the middle. So I covered up part of the mandala. Di says she sprayed hot pink all over her face when a bottle was clogged and she wasn't looking. Wait a minute, I've lost my place in my book. It's only 6 pages and I lost my place. So what I did here, to put his name in the circle, this is printed out and then it's sprayed and all that. So I punched it out with a circle punch and put his name in the circle. And it was, don't you know, it came out, I didn't spray it or cut it exactly in the middle, so I added a little tiny heart. Yeah. And then this is the back cover. So this is the date. So the book had the date on it, and then in silver pen I wrote a sentiment to him, and this is the another mandala. So there you go. So Kyla, here's my first book. This is my homework. It's submitted. I submitted my homework for this particular book. So it was and I truthfully have seen this structure done before, and it's easy to do, and I'd seen this done before, but I'd never thought of using it this way. So this was already, the price of the class is already done for me. So anything from here is gravy, because I'd never thought of doing this before, and I think I will probably use this particular structure for cards from now on. This is my kind of card, okay? I'm not a card maker. This is my kind of card. I can do this. Absolutely. Yeah. So there you go. Kyla says she can't wait till I try the challenges. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I don't know. We'll see. Life is getting busy here, I have to say. All right. So there's that. So I wanted to show you that. So I'm combining different kinds of things, right? So we're going to come back to these after a bit. We're going to let those continue drying. They're doing pretty well, but we're going to come back to that later. All right. So the next thing I want to show here, I told you we're doing a whole bunch of things. Marion got the bones of her book done. Good. Cool. Thanks. All right. So here's what we have here. So I wanted to show you, this is the next thing. So we're kind of jumping all over the place, but I just want to give you some ideas as to what to do with your mandalas. In case you want to have, you know, sometimes I want to have a thing. I just want to have a stack of stuff, you know. So I thought, well, what else can I do with it? And I thought, you know. Okay, Mitzi, thanks for hanging out. Cook something good. So I thought what I would do is I would take this mandala, which I did on the 140-pound watercolor paper. Thanks, Deb. Yes, I've been known to put many people to sleep. Our music scrap, Jean, springs to mind. So I took the mandala, which I did on 140-pound watercolor paper, colored with Inktense Pencils, right? I had more of the, you can see the brayer here. This is the brayered off paper used on the mixed media paper that I told you about, that I made the card, the box, the book card structure. So this was one where I was using different colors. And so I glued it to the back of the 140-pound, because the backside of this was messy. And so I had to cover it. So I thought, what am I going to cover it with? So I covered it using the paper that I already had. This is how I like to do. I like to make lots of papers. I'm not much on buying commercial papers, although I have a stack of commercially done papers, but I don't find myself going back to them. I do find myself going to them and covering them with other stuff, but not so much using them as they come off the pads of paper. I love creating my own stuff with paste paper or the jelly plate or whatever. And so I love doing that. And so I'll have big stacks of the paper. And so I had this, and this is 98-pound paper, and so I used that, and I used good old Aline's tacky glue, and I put that all over the back of this, and I glued it onto this, and then I put it under some weight and let it sit. So it's not perfectly flat, but I'm okay with that, right? I don't care. I don't mind. And then I cut it in half. And because it's maybe or maybe not, it looks pretty good. I was going to say it might or might not be a perfect circle, which I'm all right with too. It's pretty good. It's pretty good. All right. So then I took the same watercolor paper that we were talking about here. This is the cheap stuff from Michaels. It's Artist Loft, 90-pound, 25 sheets, $4.99. And I made circles, and then I folded them in half, and these are going to become pages in my book, and I just love this, okay? So it's going to be a book, and I'm going to hopefully get time today to stitch it together for you. We'll see. I don't know. We're going to see. Now, how I got this to be the right size. Well, it was a crapshoot. I cannot lie. It was an accidental thing. The watercolor paper, which was the heavier stuff that I did the mandala on, which is what this was done on, this is 9x12. And so I made it. Can you see how it's almost to the edges of the paper? I went as far as I could. So let's see Let's see how big this is. This one's slightly smaller than the blue-green one. And basically, I got this will allow you to have, if you start right in the center of the paper, it will let you do 8 3/4 inch diameter circle, which happened to come out to be perfect to create said book. So this was 8 3/4 inches in diameter, right? Cut it in half, made the book cover. To make the pages. Bye, Vicky, great to see you. I used watercolor paper, the 90 pound watercolor paper, as I said. I'm gonna use this. This is a cutting pad, cutting mat. So I'm gonna tear out a few sheets of this. All right, this is the cheapo watercolor paper. And I've had this in my stash for a while and I decided to drag it out and use it. This is a Fisker's circle cutter, okay? So there are different brands that make, Martha Stewart has one as well. Sorry, I'm just getting a link in case you want to take a look at it. So that is the circle cutter. For those of you watching the recording, it is, you can take a look at it here, create.me/Fiskers with an S, Fiskers circle cutter, if you want to look at it. Martha Stewart, as I said, has one as well. Anyway, it's not hard to use. But I would recommend, if you have this, if you decide, if you have one or you need to get one, then I would, the way that I chose to store it is I stapled this plastic so that I could just open it. So I stapled it here and here so I could just open and slip it out. And the reason is because the directions are on the back. I wanted to keep the directions. So this is how it works. There's a little place in it that stores the blade. So you pop that little cap off and it will dump out your blade. So it will actually store. It comes with two blades. Okay, there's one being in there. It stores two blades. So you pop out the cap to get it done, you know, toss it out. It will do circles from size 1 inch to 8 inches. Let's see. Yes, 1 inch to 8 inch. It's also measured in centimeters on one side and inches on the other side. Now, I have not gone down to do the 1 inch circle, and so I have not done that. But you just pull, it stores, you know, it goes one way to do the little bitty circles. It goes the other way if you want to do the big one. This will go up to 8 inches. The Martha Stewart one goes up to 12. And Deb says she has a colezzle cutter. I don't know, colezzle cutter. I don't know colezzle, so I don't know that. Yeah, the Martha Stewart one that I'm talking about, there's two of them. This one, the one that I'm talking about, is the one that's kind of shaped like this, not the one in a ring. But anyway, so I've pulled it out as far as it'll go. So it will go up to, it shows you in here. I don't know that you can see that because of the plastic. But right in here, it shows you an 8 right inside there. Anyway, now you tighten this ring down here underneath the orange ring that has a spring on it. You tighten that, but don't break it. It's just plastic, okay? So don't tighten it down. Don't do man tighten. To install your blade, you turn it over and you drop your little blade in. Now, if you push this on your thumb, you're going to sink that little sharp point right into your thumb. So just use your thumbnails on the edge to kind of put it in place. All right. All right. Ta-da, ta-da. So then what I did was I put this on my grid just because it was easier for me to see. So I put it on my grid. And at about the halfway point, because this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So at about 4.5 on my grid, that's where I put it. All right. Push down with your hand. This is a spring. I know you can't see that so much. Let me change positions of the camera. Let me give you a different shot of this so you can see. We'll scoot over here a little bit. There's a spring under there. Okay, now I'm going to stand up so that it's easier to do if you stand up. So you're going to put the spring down and you turn it from the outer ring. And I found I had to keep my thumb on the paper and just rotate it. And then if you want to see if you got it all, you can move the paper, the extra paper first, okay? And then that's how I got all those papers that had the rings that we dealt with earlier. And then you get this beautiful, perfect circle, which I then folded in half to become the pages for my book. All right, makes sense? So I'll show you again, just in case anybody wants to cut perfect circles. So I line it up on my grid again, just because it gives me a good starting place. So like 4.5, you know, give or take, it doesn't matter a whole lot. Put your pressure of your one hand on the knob. Turn from the outer ring. Don't push on that. Okay, that's what we tend to want to do, is push on the arm out here. Don't do that. You turn from the ring. And if I keep my thumb there, it just helps. Now I realize I'm right-handed, so if you're left-handed, you're going to have to change your instructions. Go until it cuts all the way around, and if you want to see if you cut it completely, you know, loosen the ring and then let go. But it doesn't put any holes in your paper to start with, you know, like a compass. It doesn't do that. So that's cool. All right, we'll do just one more. Just for grins and giggles. Okay, so again, I just found it easiest to line up on the grid so that I had an easy place to begin. All right, that's the only reason for using the grid. Push down on the orange, spin it, and I found I had to hold it with my thumb, otherwise the whole paper wanted to spin on me. I don't know that you could do this with anything any heavier than the 90-pound paper, but it cut it, and I did a whole bunch of pages. It cut it like butter. This one, I found it for less than $20. The Martha Stewart one's a little bit more, but it cuts a bigger circle. It goes up to 12 inch. But I have not used it, so I don't know how that... Yeah, I don't know how that works for sure. Okay, so we're done cutting circles, because I just wanted to show you how easy that was. Like, and then... I'm thinking, too, that I could take some of these already done, you know, and that would be cool to just have a bunch of circles and just sit down with circles and just make mandalas on that, you know? $11.99 at Amazon. There you go. There you go. Easy. Now, I'm going to tell you, it's not a tool that's going to last you forever and a day if you misuse it. So you have to be careful with it, because it is just that, you know, funny plastic. I don't know how to describe it. Okay, so to put it away, from the top side, you just push, because the blade's down here, right? So just push with your thumb, and the blade drops out. Easy. I'm going to show you. It does. It cut like butter. It did. Kyle's giving me grief. And then just take one of the little blue cap bits off. Oops, don't drop it on the floor. That's not good. Because that's the kind of thing that chance will get and take away. And just drop your little blade in there. Put your little cap back on. It's safely stored away. Yes, yes. Sharp things need to be stored. Then unscrew the ring that's under here. Unscrew this a little bit so it's loosened up. That way you can move this arm. And I just leave it that way. And then I just put it back in its little cutter house like that. And then it's, you know, that's how I store it. You know? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, Vaughn. It doesn't matter. If it's whatever you guys want to look at, it doesn't matter. The links that I give you are just for information. If you want to go see what I'm talking about, it just gives you more information so you can see what I'm using. Okay, so that's how I use this little cutter. That's how I cut my circles. That's how I ended up with a whole bunch of these, which I showed you earlier. That's how I ended up having this stuff left over, which I colored to show you how I got to this. Okay, see how my mind works? It's all related. It's all related. All right. So the next thing we're going to do here is I'm going to see, what time is it? 2:26. Oh, you're welcome. So what I'm going to do, because I've taken you to exactly how I got to here. All right. So I have the pages of my book, which are these exact circles, 8 inches in diameter, folded in half, are going to make a perfect book. Okay. Pages from my book. I have nested 3 of them together to make signatures of 3 of these at a time. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have 6 signatures. So this has 18 pages in it. All right. Any questions so far? You followed my rabbit trail? Woohoo! 2 thumbs up for you. If you can follow that rabbit trail, you did really well. $17.99 at Hobby Lobby with 40% off. See, there you go. If you like it, there's options available. All right, so what I did next is I took my Tim Holtz centering ruler. It doesn't have to be Tim Holtz. I particularly like the centering rulers because it has 0 in the middle. That's what it means, centering. I went across the fattest part of my ruler, or my circle, sorry, fattest part of my circle, which means there's a 4 here and a 4 here because it's an 8-inch circle. It's very convenient that way, right? It's very convenient that way. And I marked 0, which is the center point. I went out to 2 inches on each side, and then I went to 1/4 inch from the edge. And so I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 marks, right? 5 marks. So that's how I'm going to do my stitches. Now, for me to make it easy, I have a book cradle, piercing cradle. This is easy for me, and that's why I use it. You could use a an old phone book. You could use all kinds of things, but I happen to like the piercing cradle because it's easy to use. Now, I'm going to take one of these out, and the top one, I'm going to use it as my pattern, okay? So, I'm going to endeavor to keep the tops all going the same direction. We'll see how successful I am at doing this. All right, so I'm just going to nest it inside, making sure they're all even, and then I'm going to pierce the holes. You could put this whole thing inside the spine, nest it down in the spine of a big old fat phone book or encyclopedia if you have, or dictionary or whatever else. The question is Claus Man making these for sale? If you talk to him real nice, if he's here, he might do that. I don't know. They are very labor intensive, which translates into dollars. So you can talk to him about it. I have one on hand. One. So you can talk to him. But I really like them because it makes piercing the holes easy. See how the crack is in there? That's where the pointy thing goes. And so it's high enough off the table that it doesn't pierce your table. And you can line your pages up against this end. So that's what I like about it. Anyway, I'll give you his email and you can contact him. It's rlowen43@gmail.com. So you can contact him and beg him if you want to talk to him about it. He might make them, you know, he might, if you're not in a big hurry. Like I said, I do have one. And it's an investment, you know, the first time you buy it, and then you don't have to buy it again, which is cool. But anyway, I'm not on here to sell those. Okay, so that is the piercing cradle. Pages are pierced. Now, what we're going to do is we have to get the stitches transferred to the cover. Let's see. I'm going to come about that far. And I need to transfer my marks. All right. We'll see what we can find that's going to show up here. Yeah, that's true. That's true. I don't even make books all the time, but I do make them often enough that it's definitely worth it to me. I mean, I would have bought one from somebody else. Okay, let's see if we can get this centered on here. If you have the holes absolutely even, it's very helpful. If you don't have them absolutely even, then you have to be even more careful. Okay, I'm just going back and forth between black and white on the ones that I can't see for sure. Okay. So, since I am using a paint pen to mark those, I'm going to hit them with a heat gun to dry the paint, because I thought that was the only thing I'd be able to see. Okay. Now, this needs to go back in this signature, and let's see if the holes line up. Yep, okay. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to just fold these in half. I'm going to pierce these all at the same time. And because this is I am going to endeavor to pierce these at the same time. And because I can't go down in the crack of the book cradle, I'm going to pierce them with a mat on my surface. Now, I'm going to stitch this together. I don't know that I'm going to do this on camera, the stitching part. What time is it? 2:35. Because it's very difficult to show this stitching process on camera. Okay, let's see if we went all the way through. This is really thick, and so just have to work it a little bit. And when you're doing that, you have to support what you're doing, but not poke your hand, right? I'm not going to guarantee that you're going to be able to see what I'm doing when I stitch this book, and therefore that is the question about doing it on camera. All right, where are you? Here you are. Okay. All right, we have holes. Houston, we have holes. Okay, now you know if you put a piece of white paper behind them, it is the Coptic stitch, yes it is. That's what I'm gonna use, the Coptic stitch. Which is really not difficult, it's just, okay, we're going to push you through from this side, and then we'll go back and do you from the other side. This is really easy to pierce your hand when you're doing this, because you have to support the hole when it's something that is so thick. You have to support the paper or the cover around the hole, otherwise it will collapse on you. Okay, good enough. We got it. Now, in a perfect world, you make sure that you know which is the top. Okay, which I'm sure at this point I've lost track of which one is at the top. So we're going to pick one. We'll put the other one on the bottom, and Bob's your uncle, and that's that. Okay. All right, I need a drink of tea. Ah. I'm not guaranteeing that you guys are going to be able to see this. I'm not going to guarantee that at all. This is not a class about how to teach you to do Coptic stitch binding. It's just, this is a little class about showing you different things you can do with mandalas. I know. So we'll give it a shot here. I'm going to change cameras to the one that you might have the best shot at seeing. But no guarantees here, folks. No guarantees. So we're going to decide which color we want to stitch it together with. I'm thinking maybe I'm going to use this red-violet thread. And I don't start with a super long piece. I'm using wax linen thread. I'm not going to use a super long piece of thread because I don't care if I have to piece it. I'd rather tie off and piece the thread than get frustrated by the thread. Now, I'm going to tell you something. It's been a while since I've done Coptic stitch. It's been a while. Mm. I'm looking for a couple of clips here. If I need them to hold things together. So this could go, this could go horribly wrong, or it could be great. All right. Since the front and back covers of my book are exactly the same, it doesn't make any difference to me which, if I'm working from back to front or front to back. Let's see how I did this. Doesn't matter. Okay. All right. This could go bad, people. This could go bad. We're just going to have to think a minute. All right. You start from one end, and I use a curved needle, which is what, sorry, which is what I have my thread in. There's no knots. Okay. And you need to leave yourself a tail of thread. It doesn't have to be a super long tail of thread. And I'm going to clip it just to see if I can keep it from pulling through. I'm going to pick up my cover. The worst part of the Coptic stitch binding for me is you have the beginning and the end. All right. This goes from... I may have to do this twice because I didn't practice this ahead of time. Go around the cover. Okay, so I've gone around. How do I show you this? We're just going to see if this works because it's been a while since I've done it, okay? So go around the cover. The thread's on one side of the thread. The long tail, you go to the other side of that thread, so the other side of the stitch, and you go back in the hole of, let's see, is that right? No. Like I said, I may not do this on camera. Let's see if I go the other way. Let me try this one more time. Can't remember if you go around the cover that way or if you go around the cover from the inside. Let me think a minute. Nothing like thinking while you're trying to show somebody something. Go this way. Yeah, okay. So come around the cover. Keep the cover has to be lined up with your first signature. You have the thread under this, under the thread that's underneath, that's hooked to the signature, come under it. So I take a stitch under it, kind of snug it up a little bit, and then go back inside the signature. I know you can't see that. Go back inside the signature of the book. Awkward as all get out when you're starting. Awkward as all get out. And then you snug, I just snug everything up. Okay. And because you've got the tail starting, you can kind of use that to kind of work it also. And you can come back and snug this up in the end. All right, so you go to the next hole, go through the hole of the signature. Once the cover gets attached, it's not nearly as hard and fiddly and awkward to get going. And because I'm right-handed and I'm shooting over my left shoulder, it becomes difficult to see. All right, so I've gone through, I come through the signature to the next hole, okay? I come out through the signature. I'm going to go under, pick up the cover. Comes over the cover. I'm going to go under the thread. So under the thread. The curved needle really helps a lot to do this. Kind of snug it up. Go back inside the signature. Same hole you went, you came out of, you're going back inside. Like that. Go to the next one. Come out. Now, this is where you got to make sure that you're kind of keeping things snugged up, taking slack out of things. So if you need to kind of rework the stitch and just work the thread until you can get it to where it's taut. Okay, and we'll call that good. Looks not too bad. Okay, so under the cover, through the cover hole. Around the thread, around that signature thread, the thread that came out of the signature. So I go around that thread that came out. I didn't do that right. Because you actually have to go around it. It actually makes a stitch, a little teeny tiny stitch. Do not take this as a lesson on Coptic stitch. Because every time I do it, I have to I have to practice it. In fact, I filmed a video on it just so I could remember, but I forgot to watch it. Okay, so I've gone around it, and then I'm going to go back into the signature in the middle. Hello. And every time I start this, I think I'm never doing this again until it looks so cool that it's like, oh yeah, I gotta do this again. All right, and if you don't have it tightened up, you have to tighten it from the inside because you don't want these to be all loosey-goosey, okay? So I'll probably do this whole thing over when I get off camera. But you'll kind of get the idea, huh? Maybe? I'm gonna have to do it again, but I'll just show you kind of the idea because I've got to go back and get the threads tighter. Like I said, doing this on camera is not the greatest idea. All right, so we're at the last hole and we're gonna go around the thread like so. But rather than go back in that signature hole right there, we're going to pick up the next signature and put it under the book. Now, I find it easiest to just turn this whole thing over and work with the signature on the top. And so now you're going to do the same kind of thing, except you're only working with one thing. You're not having to work with the cover and a signature, you're just working with the signatures. So we've gone into the next signature, like so. You're gonna come out through the next hole. And if you need to, I find it often is helpful if you line up the signatures and the holes, and then put a clip on it that kind of helps keep things from going crazy. All right, so to connect, because every time you're creating a stitch inside the signature, but you have to hook it to the one below. Hi, Patty. So you've got it, the stitch is through the book signature. Now you have to come down and go underneath to hook it to the signature below. So this connects it to the book. Then you come back up, go in the hole. Okay, so now we're into the book. And all this has to be snugged up like that. So you have to have a nice snug stitch. Then you come out the next hole. You go down and connect it to the book. You're just looping underneath the thread from the row below. That connects them together. Go back through the signature. Okay, so we're back into the middle. Go through the next one, come out. Come down, go under the thread that connects it to the first part. You come back, go through the signature. Okay, so we're through the signature. Go through the next one. Go underneath to connect it together. All right, but instead of going back through the next, through the hole you came out of, you pick up your next signature. And you go through the hole, the first hole. All right, now this is where I usually stop, get everything evened up, put the clip back on, and then you start the process, but now you go the other way. So now we're going through the next hole, working back the other direction, and now you've got this signature is loose, and so you have to connect it. So every time you go to the row below, and just all you're doing is coming under. You're coming under the stitch from the row below, and that connects it together. And it looks like a little crocheted or a knitted stitch. Go back in the, you gotta make sure you get all the way into the middle of the signature. Okay, so you can see this little chain forming. It looks like a chain stitch. Go to the next hole, out. Go under the row below. The curved needle is just the bee's knees. I don't know how anybody does this without a curved needle. Go back in the same hole that you came out of. Go to the next hole. So it's a process of stitching through all the holes in the signature, but each time connecting it to the row below. So you've got to connect it to the row below, and then when you get to the end, you have to add on the new signature. So we're at the end hole, so we come out. You still have to connect it to the one below. So you come down, you connect it by going under the thread, but you don't go back in this one. You pick up the new one, and you start adding it in and going back. And that's how you do it. So when you get it all stitched together, which it is not, and it lays perfectly flat. This is why Coptic stitch is so appealing. The cover lays flat. The signature, the pages open up flat. See, no matter where you are in the book, it's going to lay flat. That's the appeal of the Coptic stitch. Okay? The bee's knees, that's right. So I will get this all stitched up and finished up. And the hardest part is attaching the cover to the first signature. And then when you get to the end, you have to attach the cover and the last signature at the same time. That is the challenge. Now, this is watercolor paper, so it doesn't fold down super duper flat. It wants to splay out a little bit. So I may make a closure for this book, or I may just make a belly band that slips over it or something. Or then again, I may not worry about it. But you end up with this really pretty chain stitch that goes up the spine. It's an exposed spine. Yeah. So it looks really good. Yeah, you could absolutely do it with the 8-inch, the round jelly prints. So anyway, that's that. So you guys kind of got the idea about that. So that's another idea for using the mandalas, right? Another idea. That's an idea. One last idea, and then I promise next week we will be moving on to something other than a mandalas, okay? I promise. So this is using the scraps from what we were doing earlier, and I need some black cardstock. So what we're going to do is I'm going to cut these into ATC size. Now you could make note cards out of these or whatever, but I just thought ATCs would be fun. So there's probably a much more efficient way to do this, but we're just going to go for it. So we're going to do 3.5. I'll just go ahead and cut the maximum of these, 3.5. This is just plain old Michael's cardstock in black. And I'm going to cut them 2.5 inches in width, because that's the size. If memory serves me right, that's the size of ATCs, 2.5 by 3.5. Somebody will correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sure. I do, Dar, I still have it. I absolutely do. Of course I have it. I love it, Miss Star. So we'll cut up a few of these. We won't do a ton of them. Okay, so we have a few of ATC-sized pieces of black. Okay, so I'm going to put these on top of that. So we're going to do these, 2.25 by 3.25. All right. All righty then. Let's see what we get. 2.25 by 3.25. Let's see if we get... Look at that. Look at that. Fits like... Okay, here is one of the sayings of my husband. Fits like a sock on a rooster. Yeah. I don't know what that means, but I've been married to him long enough that I have to say it, because anything that fits really well, yeah, fits like a sock on a rooster. What rooster would wear socks? Okay, and so that's what's going to be like that, right? So we'll do 2 of each color, just... That's what we're going to cut. But by doing your own stuff, by doing your own papers, you know, and using leftovers and things like that, you can get some really interesting things. Okay, did I cut this right? 3.25 is what I wanted. No, I didn't cut 3.25. Thought that looked too big, and that's because it was. 3.25 is what I want. 2.25. Okay, so we're going to do 2 of each one, as I said, so we'll have different colors. Good enough for government work. That's right, Mitzi. That's another one. He says that too. What's another one? good enough for who it's for. That's kind of crappy. That's kind of a bad one. Okay, so we've got two of each little thing cut. Did I cut enough blacks? Let's see. Monkey wearing a sock. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's right. All right, so let's ink it just to give it a little, because these are white edges, more or less. So just for grins, let's give it a little. Just because we're working with leftovers doesn't mean it can't be nice, you know what I mean? So I'm using a piece of blending foam and archival ink. So did I lose you guys when I was showing the Coptic stitch idea? As I said, that wasn't intended to be a lesson. That was only intended to give you an idea of something else you could do. So just giving the edges a little ink just to make them look a little more finished. Cats are being really good today, honestly. The sponsors are exceptionally good. I don't know why. Bob's your uncle. Me too, Mitzi. One of these days I'll do a bona fide demo of the Coptic stitch beginning to end, but it's not today. Not today. Today we had too many things to do. Okay, so we have those. So now I'm going to stick these on to the black parts. I'm just going to use ATG because it's full of tape. This would be better because of the weight of the watercolor paper. It would be better to use the double-sided tape like the score tape. But this is faster and easier for me to do. So we need an eighth of an inch. This is where I really struggle a little bit. And, you know, if I don't get the margins exactly right, then I go, oh, that's too bad. Wish I had done a better job on that. Or I'll trim it. I think Mitzi was the first one I ever heard do the Bob's your uncle thing. And I'm not worrying a whole lot if the tape is exactly next to the edge on these. More or less is good enough. So are you getting some ideas of things you can do with the mandalas? Don't forget, if you want the book at the sale price, here's the book, right? Mandala Melange by yours truly. If you want it, you got till Wednesday to get it at the $6.97 price. There's the link if you want to go get it. I can give you a clickable link here in a second. Any of you came in after the fact. Big honking tape gun scares you. I understand. Okay, there's the book again if anybody came in and didn't see the link earlier. It's not bad. It's not bad to use. It's a pain to store it because it's not a good way to store it. You know, it's big, but it really is nice to use. I wish I, someday I'm going to buy the better tape refills to go in at the gold tape. I understand they're a lot better, but I've never used it, so I don't have anything to compare it to, but I'd like to try it. I think it's the gold label or something like that. I'm sure some of you guys have tried it. And refilling it is a bit of an annoyance in the beginning until you kind of, well, it's not exactly straight, but good enough, right? All right, so there we go. So from there, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use our my little bits and pieces of mandalas that are left over, and I'm going to put some on here, and I'm going to see where they go, and they're just going to be little bits of this and that. So, and I kind of want them to blend into the background. We'll try them on different ones. So there's that one. There's that one. I don't like that one on any of them, so we'll discard that. So these are just scans or photographs of ones that I drew and colored. And I'm just cutting some of them apart just to see what they do, see where they go. Okay, that'll work. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I found that mounting jelly paper on cardstock cut postcard and ATC size of the glue stick works rather well. Yeah, that's what I did to mount everything in this, is I used glue stick. And as long as I had enough, there were a few places like in the spine area that I had to go back and use a little bit of tacky glue on a pin and stick it up, you know, inside. But for the most part, the glue stick worked really well. The drier the glue, the better I find that it works. And that's what we're going to use. So I use a piece of scratch paper. And I actually, first I'm going to ink around the edge. And of course you could use colored inks and what have you, but I'm just using the black archival. It just helps a little bit to color the core of the paper a little bit. So this is the extreme glue stick, and it's best if you work from the center out to the edges, because if you don't, you'll end up flopping it up on the top. Getting a big glue booger, which is never a good idea. And then because I'm using scratch paper, I'm just going to turn this over right away so that I don't end up putting glue on top of that. I don't know if this is the one I was going to use or not, but it's the one we're going to use now. So stick it on there, and then I use this Xandra sent me this from Ranger, and I find that you need to really burnish it very well. Pressure. If you get any glue up on the top of it, use a rag, and you know, you can rub it off usually with the rag. If you slopped it on it, and there you go. So at that point, then it's ready to Dar says, just ordered mine. Thank you. You're welcome. Do love to play coloring. Oh, good. So there's that. So now it's ready to add a word or whatever you want to add to it. So let's do this one. So it doesn't really matter where you stick it, because of course you can turn them around. So let's put one on this corner. Let's make sure that's the color we want it on. Maybe we want it on this one. Oh, maybe I want it on the green background. We'll put it on that one. Huh? Why not? But as I said, it's best if you go from the center out. And just make sure that you get an absolute thorough coat of glue stick on it. And then again, this is junk paper, so it was going to go away anyway. So it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Is this the one I was going to use? I think so. It's the one we're using now. See, if you get yourself organized, it's not so bad. And then burnish it onto the surface. If you get really good contact, and I forgot to ink the edges of that one, I find that it likes it. Does it will stay put. All right, so there we got a couple of those, or this way. I have an HP printer that reduces, but I did these inside of a Word document program. But I do have my HP 6520 does have the capability of reducing and enlarging. So I'm just inking around the edges a little bit. They do look a little better if they're inked around the edges, if you can remember that. Marie, I will give you a link if you want it. If you want to go straight to it, then you can get to it by going you can get to it by going straight to that link right there, or you can go to HowToGetCreative.com and you'll see it under the store. You can see it that way. What percentage did you reduce them? I used them in a word processing program, Mitzi, and I honestly I was reducing them down just to get a variety of sizes so I could use them for this card that I was making, this card book. How many pages? Well, I printed the images, the mandala images. I printed those on cardstock. There's 25 of those. I printed the other ones on regular paper. And I just, I'm thinking. So I printed it a few pages at a time. When I'm doing something funky with my printer, like trying to print cardstock, I just print a few pages at a time because I don't want to have a whole big whoop-ass document in my printer and it decides to do something weird, as printers are prone to do. Hi, Celebrate the Spirit, Cindy. Nice to have you join us. Okay, so there are some of those. All right, let's keep going. We got two more. That's kind of nice. It's too big, so let's cut her up. So that probably didn't answer your question very well, Dar, but there's so many variables. It depends on your printer. It depends on so many different things, you know? So we'll put this one in the corner here. And you want to turn over the glue every time you are done gluing. Otherwise, you will get yourself in a sticky situation that you didn't mean to. Once you get down to a certain point, then you just toss them away. And I didn't ink the edges of that one, but, you know. So it goes. Sometimes I remember, sometimes I don't. I think Celebrate spirit is Cindy, right? Oh, have fun, Cindy. She says she's been preparing mandalas all morning to start working with the clients. I'm now working with this kickoff mandala art. How cool is that? All right, so there's that one. All right, maybe we'll put this one on here. We'll do this. And this is going to cut off about right there. I'll put a little black ink on this one. Now I'm not going to try and ink all these little funky edges that I created for myself. I'm just going to go for the long edges. Yeah, this one was, I colored with the big brush pins. And the middle part, actually, the center part of it, the center here, I colored using Tombow watercolor markers. Because I wanted to see what happened if I combined both. Worked great. Zandra, your little creatures that you create, not only with the, mulberry paper. I forgot what those are called, that kind of piecing. I forgot what it's called. Just went right out of my head. Our darling. But the ones you did on top of the bleeding tissue cards were adorable too. Very nice. If you don't follow Zandra on Ustream, you need to do that. And she is on Wednesday nights. And the links are open if you guys want to put your channels in. Okay? You can put your channels in and YouTubes and all that kind of stuff. Whatever you want to stick in, go ahead and put it in the chat. The links are there. You can do that. Yeah, there's 34 pages. I just didn't know if you wanted, if you were intending, you know, to split it up and do paper on some and cardstock on some. Okay, this is, we're going to do this in quarters. Going to quarterize it. And Xandra's on Wednesday night. Jean's on Monday night. Who else? Paula's on Saturday night. Journal Artista. Dee Dee usually comes on bright and early on Monday morning and some other mornings. And a lot of them upload their streams to YouTube also. Another piece of scratch paper. We're almost done, folks. We're almost done. Now you could do this exact same thing with pre-folded note cards. Maybe we'll do one of those before we go, huh? That's right, Rain. It is Drama-Free Friday. Yes, ma'am. Kind of have to watch that you don't get too crazy with the glue, because I did there and I squished some out onto the black. So if that ends up shadowing, I'll have to do something with it. But anyway, there you've got your background. So then you can use text, you know, print. I almost always use text with my stuff because it's just, I like words. So I will usually print out a word or a quote or something. On these little guys, I'll probably just print out a word of some kind. So you can kind of get the gist of, let's turn that one around. So you get the gist of using the mandalas in different ways, right? With scratch paper, scrap stuff. So we'll take a quick look at these. Let's try one on craft paper. Don't know that I'm gonna like this, but hey. So this is just a pre-folded, you know, little note card. Let's see what they look like if they're not matted, just to see. Might have to put some black cardstock on them. Yeah, it gets a little busy when it gets bigger like that. Trying to make this easy for myself. They look better on black. Let's try it with one of these. This is green. This is like a postcard type thing. Oh no, it's a card. Oh, my mistake. It's a card. So let's just use, thank you, Dar. So let's just use some of these. You know. For grins and giggles, we'll slap it down. We'll just slap it down. Oh yeah, and John and Darcy are on tomorrow, right? Scrappy Camper Sisters. Hi, Meg. Now, as I said, I am not a great card maker. So, here, we could do this. Here, we can do this. Let's do this. All right, my fan is on. It's trying to blow my stuff around. That's no fun. Hi, cheeky girl. I haven't seen you for a while. Hope you're doing all right. So does anybody have any questions while I'm finishing this stuff up? What did I do with my hair? No guarantees that this one's going to come out to be any work of art, but, you know, hey. And if I wanted to get the circle maker back out, I could, or the circle cutter, I could get it out and I could actually probably cut this better. But we're not going to worry about that, because what we're after is just getting her done. So I'm just putting these on black, and I'm going to make it easy for myself because I'm going to just take another piece of black that has square corners on it. Given the fact that maybe it's square here. All right, then we're going to cut these out. Now, this would be much better if you cut them out using a circle cutter. It's a handmade thing. You know what I mean, people? It's a handmade thing. You could mount these on fun foam, which you'd have to be a little more picky about the way you cut the circle. But you could mount them on fun foam to give them some dimension up off the card if you wanted to. Or those pop dot things or whatever, which I never do use. But you can use fun foam to do it. So I'm just gauging roughly the same amount of black around it. This is a little big down here, so we'll cut that down a little bit. I know I'm off camera here, but I'm trying to see what I'm doing. And black is just a total pain in the butt. Excuse my French. Okay, so let's say that there's our card, and we want to put this like that and like that. And you could even take, circles, and you could nest them behind each other. I mean, the sky's the limit. You can just place them the way you want. That's right, Joyce. That's right. So you could put them on there the way you like. Then you've got room to doodle some other stuff. You could doodle some, repeat some of the shapes that you have in the various mandalas. You could doodle some of those around in it. I mean, you could do a lot of stuff, right? Add some words, add a one big word. You can put this over, connect these two together. So you've got those groups, and then you got room for a word, and you could, you can do all kinds of things. But the point is, you can take what you've already done and you can use it multiple ways. You know, you don't even have to have them all mounted with black. You could have this little guy, there. You could turn it into whatever you want to turn it into, stick some more on there, cover it up. Anyway, you got the idea. So, no cards, ATC cards. You got plenty of room on the ATC cards to put words, sentiments, whatever you want to do. You got room on the back. You can use a colored gel pen. You can add stuff on the back. You can do all kinds of stuff, right? Yeah. So, there you go. Let me check my notes, see if we got everything that we intended to do today. And then don't forget, you can use them to decorate things. This was from Kyla's One Page Wonder class, making this simple little book, turning it into a card. So you can do stuff like that, a multiple page structure. And yeah, that's it. That is it. So any questions from anybody? Yeah, mandala pocket letter, absolutely, because these would be the perfect shape or size for those. Perfect size. If I had an extra pocket, which I don't, but if I had an extra pocket, we'd just stick them right in there. Absolutely. So you can just play. That's the whole thing. But using, I like having different ways that I can use what I've already done. You could do them on, stick them on a journal page. Do a whole journal page using the mandalas. You know? Know what I mean? Yes, it's time for the sponsors. I'm trying to make room. Because we know how this goes. They always want up on the table. So I'll get the Coptic Stitch book stitched together properly for you next week. So you'll be able to see that. And I hope everybody understood this was not intended to be a class to teach you how to do the Coptic Stitch. It was just an idea. All right, sponsors. Sponsors are coming. Don't forget to check out HowToGetCreative.com. That, in case you guys don't know, if there's anybody here that doesn't know. Oops. That is the new website. It is open to the public. It will be a membership site before long, but it is now open to the public. Everything's open. So you can see what the classes are like and so forth and so on. So check it out if you'd like to. And yeah, let me get the sponsors. Okay. Hi, Lori. Good to see you. Let me see if they want to come out. They may not want to come out. You coming out? Hello. Are you coming out? Come on. You gonna come see the peoples? Hmm? You gonna come see the people? The people want to see you. Yes, the people want to see you. They like to see you for some reason. For some reason, they want to see your silly face. Yep. For some reason, this is Chance, sponsor number one. Rubbing his head on one of the cameras. All right, let's put this up here so they can see your pretty face. There he is, folks. There he is, sponsor number one. Are you coming up too? Are ya? You coming up? Come here. Come here. Come on. Yeah. And here's sponsor number two, Max and Bubba. Oh, Max and Bubba, say hi. Oh, okay. Max and Bubba, what great names for cats. This is Chance. This is Charlie. Chance regularly tries to turn his nether regions to the camera. We try to keep him from doing that. Yeah, Charlie is here. He has to say hello too, right? Oh, they've just not had any scratches for so long. Oh my goodness. Yes, you just had to get your scratches. You've been without them for at least, what? 2.5 hours. Oh my goodness. Yes. Chance, this one is a blue point Siamese. This one, Charlie, is a chocolate point Siamese. And they, in case any of you didn't know, they lived with someone else as kittens. They're not litter mates. They are from two different, they're a year apart in age. And she was, I believe she was a nurse, and she had to, she was traveling too much, and so she wasn't able to give them the amount of time that they needed. So she needed a place for them to go, and I had no cats. And I'd never lived with Siamese cats before, and so I needed, I was willing to give it a try. And so they came here to live, and they've been here for 3 years now. You're kind of hogging the camera, buddy. You're kind of hogging the camera. Your friend doesn't get much camera time. So anyway, that's how they came to be here. So why don't you lay down here so everybody can see you both. There we go. Max and Bubba are two Blue Point rag dolls. Oh, how cool is that? All right. Well, the boys and I, the sponsors and I, are now going to head off into the sunset. We're going to drive off into the sunset as soon as I find the mouse. Lay down here. And we will see you next week, same time, same place. I know, doesn't it, Patty? Patty thinks it looks like my top looks like a jelly print. It really does. And Meg has a kitty with cream-colored Siamese with light blue eyes. Yeah, these guys have blue eyes, too. Yeah. Okay, thanks for spending Friday with me, and I will see you next time. I promise we'll move on from mandalas to do something next week that I don't know what it is. Stay tuned, and I will see you guys next week. Same time, same place, same station. If you've enjoyed being here, tell your friends and share it on the world wide web with whatever. Hi, Glenda. And Jean's cats are Blue Point Himalayans. Cool. It's nice that we all have so many animals and things. Yeah. Thanks, Patty. You, same to you. Have a great weekend, too. And I'll see you guys next time. So before Chance decides to, you know, in spite of my best efforts, show his nether regions to the world, we're going to go. So we'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.